this is Jewish state. It has to become the state of all the citizens. And then there will be less conflicts. Recently, there was actually during the so-called Annapolis process, there was a meeting of President Bush, Abu Mazen, and Ehud Olmert. And President Bush and Ehud Olmert, in fact, I would say even Ehud Olmert, decided that's the good moment, finally, to have a historical understanding between us and Abu Mazen. And he told him, look, you are weak now, we are ready to strengthen. We want to help. We want that you'll have your state like we have our state. But we ask one thing, recognize our right to exist as Jewish democratic state. And President Bush, by the way, was absolutely sure that his friend Abu Mazen will say it. He said, of course, it's time to recognize it. And Abu Mazen said, to big surprise, by the way, I know it from both, from Olmert and from Bush. They were surprised when he said what he was saying. He said, we will never recognize it. Who needs this racism of the past? Who needs, why there must be specifically Jewish state? It must be state of all the citizens. Well, I will not go now into all this hypocrisy. Of course, Israel, as every democratic state, is state of all the citizens. What means that all the citizens have basic rights there. But yes, that is a state with a national agenda. And exactly as Germany, let's say when Iron Curtain fell, so Germany came to the Soviet Union and said, all the citizens in whose ID is written German, even if their great-grandparents came 300 years at the time of Ekaterina the Great, they came from Germany. They, all of them, can get German citizenship. They didn't say it to 150 other nationalities in the Soviet Union. And nobody thought that it's wrong, because it's natural for the national state of Germany to be concerned about. France is financing, if you don't know, French courses or French language all over the world. It's not financing Italian courses. So it's also natural. But Israel as a Jewish state has much bigger challenges. But what is important for our lecture? For those who don't care about a Jewish national state, or they don't care about their own Jewishness, they don't care about others' ideas, but they do care about freedom. As those who are telling me, if you want to care about freedom, you must be universal. So they do care, they are happy with the fact that there is one small island of freedom in the Middle East. Yeah. And they say, keep it as this. Don't turn it into dictatorship. Resist. But what it means? It means that there must be generations of people who are ready to fight and to die in order to defend this island of democracy. And I'm telling you, there is no way that there will be generations of people who will be ready to die if they don't have strong identity, if they don't feel themselves part of the history, the last defenders of the Jewish civilization. So if you really want to protect Israel as a democratic state, it must be a strong national state. The future of the Middle East, as I see, and I wrote about it many books, I spoke about it in different governments and so on. The future peace of the Middle East will be when there will be democratic Israel, a democratic Palestinian state, strong in their beliefs in freedom and democracy, with developed civil society, with developed institutions, and also with strong identities. And the sin of the free world, including Israeli leaders, is in constant attempts to build peace in the Middle East, not even ignoring the principles of freedom and democracy, but deciding that the only way for us to have peace is to find a dictator on the other side who will deliver us peace and stability. My first article against the Oslo Agreement was written 2 weeks after Oslo Agreement, though at the moment of signing the ceremony, I also was inspired as many others. But then when our prime minister then said, it is good that Yasser Arafat is a dictator because, I quote, without Supreme Court, without human rights organizations, and without heart-bleeding liberals, he will fight Hamas much better than we can do. That sounds like irony. That was said in October 1993, 2 weeks after the ceremony. And then I wrote my first article against it. I said, we will do everything to make him a strong dictator, and he, as a dictator, he will do everything to make his people hate us more and more, because there is no other way for dictator to survive. Dictator needs external enemy, and there is no replacement for external enemy there in the Middle East to Yasser Arafat but we. And then it was a policy for many years of the so-called peace process to create strong, corrupt dictatorship. It was, I participated in many negotiations in America and other places where again and again Western leaders were saying the most important thing is that Arafat will be strong. And if it means, don't think for a moment, every month $30 million belonging to Palestinians go put into the private pocket of Yasser Arafat by Israel, blessed by the West. And each time when I was raising question, maybe we'll stop transferring this money to private account of Yasser Arafat through Tel Aviv to Paris. The answer always was, it's Paris agreements. The West will not permit us to do different. Why? What was the logic that free world, where politicians are losing their power for putting $1 in their private pocket, and here $30 million every month of public money are put. The logic was that if that is pocket money, which Arafat needs to fight Hamas, to be strong. So it's small price. So we, free world, including America, including Europe, including Japan, but of course Israel, we helped to build one of the most primitive and corrupt dictatorships from which suffered everybody, and of course Palestinians. And then in the end, when we are giving them choice, we are giving elections where there are no civil society built, but there is a choice between this hated dictatorship, corrupt dictatorship, and noble Hamas. Palestinians choose Hamas. And then all the world says, well, that's what happens when you're giving to Muslims democracy. You give them democracy, you get terror. So, first sin of the free world is that we again and again, Arafat was not the first case, again and again, from the beginning of the 20th century, the free world tries to bring stability to itself by strengthening dictators in the Middle East. And the second sin, of course, is belief that the best way that the free world can contribute to defending peace is erasing our own identities. I believe that exactly as in the case of individuals who are fighting for their right to be free, and in the case of countries who are trying to defend its freedom, in the case of civilizations, the only way that we can defend our freedom and build a stable world is to connect very deeply.